Thanks very much and good morning. And I've been asked to say a little bit about my career path, and I'm well qualified, I believe, to do that. I've had more career around here than most people. I came here in 1975, so my advice to you, and I'm probably preaching to the choir in this regard because we have all of these bright minds here looking at different sorts of careers, but find a career that you're passionate about, that you want to, if you're excited to go to work in the morning and so on. So, and I feel that probably all of you will achieve that. And although working for a paycheck is okay too, but it's a lot more rewarding to have a passionate career. At 4 years of age, I discovered, or recall, I guess, that I had an interest in plants, and I've been able to pursue that interest for a number of years and actually turn it into a career. I did have some diversions along the way. I was interested in fish for a while and did a lot of training and fishing and pickling and trying to identify fish as a young person. And also, at one point I thought a career in microbiology would be great, but after a couple of semesters in a very hot, not such a pleasant smelling microbiology lab, I decided I would sooner be working outdoors. I've been able to, I like traveling in addition to plants, I like traveling, so I've been able to travel considerably to a number of different parts of the world in pursuit of my research. And the projects that I've worked on here have been considerably varied, from studying the local flora to doing work with Margaret Stones, as was indicated in the introduction. And she's a world-class botanical illustrator who was at Kew Gardens for 25 years and was the principal illustrator for Curtis's Botanical Magazine, which is, oh gosh, something that started in the late 1700s to make plants known to people around the world. I got a bachelor's degree in biology from Northern Iowa. I grew up in Iowa, and unlike Ivana, when I looked around, I saw not desert, but cornfields, and interspersed maybe with soybean fields and no mountains. So although I have worked to some extent in the western states and have enjoyed it very much, there certainly are some interesting plants there. After receiving my bachelor's degree, I taught high school for a couple of years and decided I did not want to do that for the next 40 or so years. And so I went through graduate school and did master's and doctoral degrees at the University of Georgia, and also postdoc at the University of Texas, Austin. Jobs such as mine are relatively rare, and people who have these positions tend to stay in them for a very long time. So there are not a lot of job openings in this field. So if you want to pursue this type of career, I would recommend you be very persistent in that regard. So let's see. I'll talk first of all a little bit about the herbarium position that I hold as director and curator. Certainly one thing that has changed since I started here is technology. When I was a graduate student, photocopy was a big deal. There were no computers, no cell phones. So it's just amazing the technological changes that have taken place. As an undergrad, they made copies of tests. I'm not quite sure how they did them, but We did have copies of tests. So let's see if we can move on to the next slide. Okay, a herbarium. I'll talk about that for just a brief moment or two. We are located directly beneath the herbarium. If we had a glass ceiling here, we would be looking into the herbarium. And the herbarium there, as you can see, is a collection of preserved plants. They're stored, cataloged, and arranged. It's like a library in many respects, in that it contains information available to whomever wants to use it, mostly by professionals, but also amateurs interested in natural history as well. And it serves a number of purposes. One is identification. There are plant diversity is quite high, second only to insect diversity on this planet. There are approximately 300,000 or so species of vascular plants, so that's quite a huge number. And also, the specimens serve to help us keep track of what are the names of all of these organisms through the designation of type specimens. So type specimens are really very important in that regard. So, and the collections form, the bedrock for information about biodiversity on the planet. This is how biodiversity is documented, through collections of specimens. And the specimens themselves can be used in all sorts of research, morphological research, biochemical research. Plants, of course, are little plant, little chemical factories. They manufacture all sorts of interesting and very unusual organic compounds. I'm sure that most of you are aware that 25% or so of the drugs that we use today are based on natural plant products. And even plant specimens that are 100 or more years old may contain DNA that can still be used in research. And so herbaria have been around for a long time and serve quite a number of important functions. And this is just a picture to show the specimens are preserved for the most part by drying. We do have a few other sorts of collections, samples pickled in solution and things like that, but mostly they're pressed and dried. They are stored in metal cabinets. These are insect-proof cabinets, and one of the big challenges is to keep various sorts of beetles from eating the plants. So, and all of this material is archival. I noticed that the herbarium that the specimens are mounted on says 400-year guarantee. So anyway, it's archival. At LSU, we have two named herbaria, the Louisiana State University Herbarium, and then the Bernard Lowy Mycological Herbarium. The LSU Herbarium began in 1869, and it's one of the oldest in the Southeast, so we are approaching nearly 150 years of existence. The state of Louisiana contracted with an individual called named America Featherman to study the plants and document what plants are growing in Louisiana. And we still have his original collections from around the 1860s or so. In total, we have approximately 300,000 specimens. And one thing that we've been working on since about the early 1990s is to database the information in the collections, and we have the online herbarium database on our herbarium website, and you can see LSU online herbarium. And in addition to the specimen data, we have a large number of other tools that are useful for mapping and identification and so on. In addition, we are supplying data to a number of national and international data consortia. CERNEC is a southeastern consortia. Herbaria throughout the southeast, they're cooperating there. SciNet is the Southwest Environmental Information Network. Got some pictures of mountains there. So even though it's centered in Arizona, it serves a much wider area. IDIG Bio is an initiative at the University of Florida, a national initiative to help get out information on biodiversity, and they are beginning to do a number of very interesting things there. This is a project that started only a few years ago. GBIF is a global biodiversity information facility worldwide, and also there are consortia for lichens and fungi. So now I'll shift gears a little bit and talk briefly about research that I do. Most of my research has been in the plant family Asteraceae, which is the sunflower family or daisy family. And there you can see a picture of a couple of the members of this family. It is the largest plant family on the planet in terms of numbers of species. There's an estimated roughly 30,000 species worldwide. So that means that roughly one species in 10 is a member of the Asteraceae. In Louisiana, it makes up about 12% of the flora. California is also about the same, and the same is true for Texas. The name Asteraceae is based on the type genus for the family, which is Aster. It has an alternative name, Compositae, which is an older but still a name that is acceptable to be used. And the name Compositae refers to the inflorescence, or the way that flowers are clustered together on an individual plant. These clusters are called heads, capitula, or pseudanthia. When you get into this type of work, you have boatloads of terminology and often various sets, similar sets of terminology. But a pseudanthium is a collection of tiny individual flowers arranged such that looks like a much larger flower, and I'll show you an example of that. The study of the family is referred to as synantherology because the anthers that produce the pollen are fused, so fused anthers. The family grows worldwide in every continent except Antarctica, which has, I think, only two or three species of vascular plants, and these are, I don't know, grass and a sedge or two grasses or something like that. But, the Asteraceae are regarded as extremophiles in that they inhabit areas that are arid. So there are a lot of Asteraceae in desert areas, in high elevation areas, and also in high latitude areas, so toward the poles and at higher elevations. They're less numerous in tropical ecosystems. The Orchidaceae, or the orchid family, has almost an equal number of species, but they have a very different lifestyle. They are adapted. Most of them are epiphytes. That is, they grow on the branches of other plants. They're not parasites, but they just rest on them. And they are most abundant in tropical regions. Most of the Asteraceae are herbaceous plants, but there are quite a few that are shrubs. There are even some trees and some vines as well. And there's a number of other technical features that are shown there that as a the characteristic for there are quite a number of different characteristics that will allow you to very positively identify that the plant belongs to the Asteraceae. The problem begins after that. So just show you a couple examples. This is a Youngia japonica, which grows outside of the building and in weedy areas such as that. And this is a Sudantium, in which this is a collection of a number of individual flowers, but as a whole, it looks like an individual flower. So, and here you can see Lindheimer texana, the yellow Texas star. Again, a number of individual flowers that look like a much larger flower. And this shows the structure of the individual flowers. They're quite small, usually only a few millimeters. This is a millimeter scale up here. And there's quite a bit of diversity in the floral structure, even in such small flowers, and even in the fruit type. Again, this is a half millimeter scale, so these are quite small fruit types, but again, there's lots of diversity, and they exhibit a lot of different adaptations for dispersal. In some parts of the world, the Asteraceae become the dominant species, such as in the Great Basin. All of these yellow flowering shrubs are rabbit brush in the genus Ericomeria. And just to point out the extremophile nature of many of the species, here they're growing out of cracks in granite rocks. I believe this is in eastern California, in the mountains in eastern California. And also here's another one. Little shrubby plants, a few inches high, growing out of the cracks of boulders. You wonder how they can survive, but they seem to be doing quite well. The Asteraceae has a number of important economic uses. Probably the most notable here is their use for vegetable oil, sunflower oil, and safflower oil. Also something that we probably eat almost every day. Lettuce is a member of the Asteraceae, and so are some of the other leafy vegetables, such as endive, radicchio, and so on. Also the artichokes are members of the Asteraceae. They're also quite noteworthy for providing a number of horticultural ornamentals, such as chrysanthemum, gerbera daisies, zinnias, echinacea. A number of species are not so nice in that they are produce allergens, ambrosia, which is ragweed, and iva, which is a relative of ragweed, which grow abundantly in our area and in most habitats in the U.S. So most people are exposed to ragweed pollen, and many people are sensitive to that. Herbal remedies such as echinacea and milk thistle are derived from species of Asteraceae. And a lot of species are weeds that are of some concern in many ecological habitats in that they are important in changing the native vegetation. They're displacing native species. And also a number of things. Louisiana is famous for coffee, and chicory and coffee is an important flavor in this part of the world. And some of the pyrethroid insecticides come from various species. Also, latex rubber is produced by some of the species. I don't know that it's done commercially, but that avenue has been and is being explored. Just a field showing commercial sunflower production as a commodity. Sunflower is second only to soybean as a vegetable oil. And it's grown a lot more in Europe and Asia than it is here in the U.S. It's grown mostly in the U.S., in the northern U.S., where precipitation is lower and the soils are not quite as rich. We probably won't see much sunflower production in our area. One of my main interests is in the classification and phylogeny of the Asteraceae, and which has changed very little. The understanding of the classification and relationship among Asteraceae have been of interest to botanists for a couple of centuries, actually, going back to Cassini in around 1816. And the concept for the evolution of the Asteraceae has changed very little until the current study that I'm going to talk about. And those early investigators indicated or felt that Helianthae, the group of genera that contains Helianthus, the big yellow sunflowers, the quintessential sunflowers, were central to the development or ancestral to all of the other ones. This just shows some of the diagrams generated by Cassini in 1816. So here you can see the helianthoid Asteraceae at the base, and he was showing all of the other Asteraceae being derived from it. And in the middle, we had thistles, and up at the top, we had lettuce and some of the other groups of plants. This project is the result of an international consortium of researchers called PICA, the International Composite Alliance, which is interested in promoting research in this particular family. And this is truly an international endeavor, and there's a very long list of people who have contributed to the project. Vicky Funk at the U.S. National Herbarium at the Smithsonian is one of the prime movers of this project. And the result from this was to take molecular data that had been generated by various investigators throughout the world as much as available and construct a super tree. And the initial results began with Panero and Funk. And there are a lot of different protocols for conducting super trees. The one that was used here was a meta super tree or a mega super tree, in which a base tree was established based on the available data, and then other branches were grafted on as appropriate. Also, the tree that resulted from this is color-coded for different geographic parts of the world. In general, the reds represent the areas in South America, the blues, Africa, the greens, Asia and Europe, and the yellows, North America and Mexico, primarily. And this is the resulting tree, and the thing to pay attention to are the colors. This is the base of the tree down here. And what would we expect to see? Based on what everybody said for 200 years, we'd expect yellow to be at the base of the tree. Well, they were only 180 degrees off. Yellow is at the top of the tree and not at the base. So the base of the tree, you recall, is South America, and in fact, Central South America seems to be the place of origin, evolutionary origin, as best we can tell, for the Asteraceae. I might point out, too, that another small plant family in southern South America, the Calyceraceae, appears to be a sister group. So that fits in too nicely with the hypotheses that are suggested here. So then South America, a lot of green here. And then blues, Africa, and again North America. This is a condensed version of where you can maybe see the colors a little bit more clearly. So again, South America appears to be the origin, and the most derived species are in North America, with others in between. So what do we know as a result of this study? Well, the basal radiation appears to be South America, and the basal clades inhabit the oldest rocks in South America, that is the Southern Andes, the Guiana Shield, the Brazilian Shield, and the central part of Africa is dominated by the African radiation, based on many clades, and the oldest rocks in Southern Africa. And the origin of extant Helianthe appears to be North America. Now, this is a very much more complex story than I'm portraying here, because there appears to be geographical movement back and forth from North America back to South America and so on. So I'm just going to talk about a few of the highlights, or just pointing out a few of the highlights of this study. Okay, following the evolution in southern South America, there appears to have been an explosion in the radiation of species in Africa, and that extended into North America. And then the Northern Africa, Mediterranean areas, and Asia, and Europe also played important roles in the radiation of certain groups. This is the thistle group, or artichoke group, the lettuce group, and a couple of others. This is the chrysanthemum group here. So, major radiations in Hawaii and Australia are more recent. Northwestern Andes was at one time thought to be the cradle of evolution, but that does not appear to be the case. And none of the clades in North America occupy basal positions in the phylogenetic tree. So of what value is this data? Well, it's interesting to know more about the organisms that we coexist with on our planet, but also it allows us to give a predictive value to some other things. For example, the origin of the Hawaiian flora is very interesting in that Hawaiian islands are volcanic and they are located about as far from any land mass as possible. So the plants growing on the Hawaiian islands came from somewhere. So where did they come from? How did they get there? I'm not sure how we know how they got there, but somehow they got there. And if we look in the Asteraceae, we can see that there are certain Vernoniae that are from South America. We can see that Asteraceae from Africa contributed to the Hawaiian flora. And the tarweed in California also offered a source of plants that invaded Hawaii. And subsequent to their invasion of Hawaii, they evolved into a number of different diverse groups, such as the unusual and beautiful Hawaiian silver sword plant. So, and there's some dating that goes on here, 65 million years before the present, and so on. So the evolution, or the family, seems to have began to evolve about 65 million years ago, whereas in North America, the invasion was about 20 or 30 million years ago, as best we can understand. Also, pollen is quite diverse in the Asteraceae. This shows some of the pollen grains, and pollen is important in plant reproduction. It carries the male gametes. And also, pollen is very persistent and long-lasting. The pollen walls can last in the earth for millions and millions of years, so it's important in studying the layers of stratigraphy, or geographic layers in the earth. And so the question is, are these different kinds of pollen grains just randomly distributed throughout the family, or are some types found associated with certain groups? And here you can see some of the information there. So this should help in a number of things relative to pollen. Okay. And we can go on. So character evolution, and so on and so on, are lots of things that can be predicted from the trees that have been generated. And we've just barely scratched the surface. There are a lot of things. We've listed a few things that we do know. There's a lot of things that we don't know. All right, thanks.
Well, does anyone in the audience have any questions?
Maybe all wanting to rush out and get a sandwich with lettuce on it or something.
Are there any theories as to how these plants ended up in Hawaii?
Could you repeat that?
Are there any theories as to how the plants got to Hawaii?
Any theories as to how? Well, yeah, there are plenty of theories, but we don't have any great evidence for that. I guess rafting is probably one of the most plausible explanations, where debris, you know, logs fall in the water from shorelines here and there and are carried around the world by ocean currents. What was it, in Alaska or in, what is the story here, in Japan? Debris from, was it the nuclear meltdown plant? Oh, the tsunami. The earthquake tsunami, which precipitated the nuclear problems. Yeah, that's it. Debris showed up on the coast of Washington State, you know, from Japan. So rafting seems like a very plausible explanation.
Any questions from the remote sites? Report? Anything? You may have to you already unmuted. Okay. No, quiet there. Primate Center? Shaking your head. New Orleans, in the dark room there. And you just have to speak up. No, I guess not. Wave at us. Show us that you're awake. I'm not sure they're alive over there. In
yeah, that's good.
I figured y'all would be the party bunch, you know, in New Orleans. Any more questions here?
Yeah. Speaking of alive, let me just interject. I tell plants that, or tell plants, tell, I probably talk to plants too, but I tell students that if they like oxygen and if they like to eat, they've got to love plants. Yeah.
All right, so my question is more from the genetic side and the interactions of the actual mapping that you guys are doing and how that's mapping over with other species of plants. What is the forefront of that research that's going for?
Well, this is an area that is progressing at a very rapid technological pace. we started running hand gels and we could maybe read 500 base sequences if we were lucky. And now with the various Illumina processes and the technologies, we can now get millions of base pairs, read much more data than we can even begin to understand. So I guess that's going to be the next big cutting edge thing, is trying to process all of the data that we can collect. Yeah, it's a fabulous challenge.
All right, any other questions? Okay, well, could everyone thank Dr. Ivana Gleason and Dr. Lowell Urbatsch?
Thank you.